You ordered what?
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the midday Dean Callan show. It's a first. We're doing some day drinking, but I didn't want to wait any longer. I'd planned, as you might have noticed, I'm starting to actually plan ahead for my guests. But when I had an opportunity to have Paul Mathew come in and talk Everleaf, which is a product I'm really passionate about, I didn't want to waste any time. I wanted to get it done right away. So we're doing a special Friday afternoon, 2 p.m. episode of the Dean Callan Show. And if you are watching the show on a regular basis, you might have noticed that last night, like, the show just died on me. So I'm glad that it's working this time. If you see any audio issues or streaming or video issues, let me know in the comments. But without waiting any longer, Paul.
Hello.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Let me go to this view, right?
So
you can see
this.
Everything. Awesome. I like it. I've never done this where I've got, like, look at that. I'm in two different.
I'm in the picture twice.
Yeah, you're in the picture twice.
Okay.
I figure, like, in case I did want to cut back to me presenting something, you'd always be in the little mini box.
Great, I need to be on my toes.
Right, so how are things?
Life's full of ups and downs. I think we can all say this year.
It's been an unprecedented year, hasn't it?
It certainly has, yeah. we've obviously been juggling the bars and Everleaf and rebranding of Everleaf, and also family time and homeschooling and things.
I almost forgot you have bars. Man, that's huge. So you've launched a brand right into COVID.
Well, yeah, relaunched, I guess. Rebranded and launched a couple of new products over COVID, which has been fun with supply chain and sourcing stuff and even getting boxes made.
I'm not joking. So for anyone that's actually watching, right, this box, and we are live. Yeah, I think we are.
I hope so.
We'll just pretend like we're live.
Okay.
We can check on our phones. We'll do a Mitch's Minute and just double check. But for anyone watching, this box is the box that it actually, like, it wasn't like Amazon where you get a box and then a box around the box and loads of extra packaging. It arrived like that, right?
Yep.
And if you look, I meticulously, because I immediately fell in love with the packaging as I opened it, I meticulously, like, with a knife, cut the sticker off, the postage, postage sticker, because it was on the top, and I wanted to be able to present the box well on the video. So the number 6, I can't get rid of.
Yeah.
That's not normal, right?
It's something to do with the drops that they do and the packaging. So
I had to, like, I got my sharpest knife and perfectly. There's a tiny bit of a scuff there, but otherwise.
Splendid attention to detail, thank you.
Box is intact. I love this. So yeah, like, everything has been a bit of a mission with COVID, right?
Yeah, everything's been a bit of a mission, but obviously we're doing so much more in the way of off-trade sales online. That we want the unboxing thing to be an experience for people. We want people to enjoy that.
I started unboxing it and then I realized how nice it was. And also, actually, can we just do it?
Go for it.
All right. So everyone can see here, I'm doing an unboxing. I love the unboxing things. Right. So maybe we cut to that view.
It's made for it.
So this is the box. And when you open this, you get complex non-alcoholic aperitifs made with depth, aroma, and flavor of the natural world. And then you got all the little leaves. This struck me straight away. I was like, awesome. So definitely worthwhile printing on the inside.
Excellent.
Did it come like that, or you decided to?
Oh no, it's definitely.
Yeah, it wasn't an accident.
Lots of decisions.
And then in here, I think there was a little bit of soft packaging there, but basically.
These little wings should hold it all apart.
How cool is that?
We're working on it.
Where did you?
Some tweaks.
So are they a standard thing? Or
no, they're all custom.
You had them developed?
Yeah.
That's so cool. All right.
It's pretty standard to have them custom made, but to get them all printed and.
All right, so we've got the
long process.
Crisp and refreshing marine. We've got complex and bittersweet forest, and we've got vibrant aromatic mountain.
Yep.
So which one is the original one?
The forest.
So forest is the original.
One in the middle is the original. So
okay.
It was just Everleaf up until last month. And Everleaf was Everleaf.
And that's the packaging. I'm going to keep this box.
It's quite a useful size, actually. I've got all sorts stored.
Loves boxes, so we're going to probably put some toys in here, or put the baubles in there after Christmas, because it's
okay, cool.
It's actually substantial on the sides. This is what made me fall in love with it, like how neatly it's been designed.
We did a lot of drop testing. Make sure the bottles don't break when you drop it from, I can't remember what it was, like 2 meters you have to be able to drop it from. For some distributors to be able to do it.
Okay, well, have a look at that. So you probably can't see it from there, but if you look at this, so all three of them sit out here. I'm gonna go back to there. Are you able to just in give us the unique selling points on these three, right? I know it seems a bit random. We went from how are you to like open the box.
No, let's crack on.
But I kind of got to be excited when I started thinking about it.
So with the original Everleaf, it was all about kind of complex bittersweet flavors made with natural ingredients, made with plants that meant something to me, made with flavors that I like as a bartender. So bittersweet is pretty obvious for that. But also a lot of them kind of, for me, draw cues of forests. The kind of earthiness, the flavors from the barks that we use, some of the floral botanicals. So when I was looking to kind of grow it and have more variants, because there are so many plants out there that I want to play with, but I really wanted to grow it. It kind of, to me, it made sense to call this one forest.
Yeah.
And I've kind of likened them all to a bit of a journey. So they're kind of a hypothetical journey through a wonderful forest that you walk in and you get aromatics from flowers up in the canopy of the forest. Then you get kind of spicy flavors from the barks and things that we use. So we've got things like cassia bark, we do have barks. Vanilla is obviously a tropical epiphyte that grows on that kind of layer underneath the canopy.
Yeah, it's interesting because when I was in Borneo, I actually went to find some wild vanilla growing. So
there's orchids that kind of drape off the branches.
Yeah.
And then we've got herbs from the understory that give that kind of bittersweet and earthy character to it. So we've got roots, barks, and flowers. So okay, to me, it was like the journey through this forest.
I love gentian.
Yeah.
I love the new bottle. I have to say, I might have to like, I've got this one here. I'll have to hide that away, right? Do I keep that?
Yeah, we've got a little bit stashed if you want the original. But
I love this though. It's beautiful. Right, so we've got forest first, right? That's forest. Now, marine.
So again, looking at journeys, obviously talking to consumers over the last 2 years since we launched, just under two, some people don't like bitter. So we wanted something that was still complex and interesting, but didn't have quite as much bitterness to it. And lots of people wanting an alternative to gin. I know there are lots of gin alternatives out there now, but we wanted one to fit the portfolio. But for me, these kind of coastal flavors are wonderful things to work with as a bartender, and that kind of umaminess to it. So I wanted something that used seaweeds. So we actually have a base of green tea for that one, that we then layer seaweed flavors on. So we've got kelp and dulse. Kelp is like the traditional kind of seaweedy seaweed, and dulse is a little bit sweeter and peppery. And then we've got some of the traditional gin botanicals. There's a little bit of juniper, citrus coming from bergamot. So on the kind of journey thing again, to me, this is kind of swimming through kelp forests just off the coast. And you have kind of a brilliant time swimming through these fronds of kelp. And then you just lie back on the beach afterwards and you get the smell of bergamot coming down from the mountains. There's olive leaf in there. So you kind of that olive grove.
This pairs well with tonic water.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can I make a drink with this right now?
Go for
now?
It, please.
I'm getting excited. So have you heard of coast mixers?
I have heard of them. I've not tried them before.
Okay, so.
But for me, this is a lot of umami. It's got some salinity.
So this is the thing. So coasts, the guys that created Coast, they're inspired by coastal beaches in, you know, around the world. And part of the money that they make from this goes back into cleaning beaches up and cleaning up the coast.
Amazing.
And I believe this has a little bit of, you know, crisp, green, playful, tonic water is wonderfully fresh nose. It's got a little bit of citrus, a little bit of salinity to it. And I think it's got seaweed or something in it. I can't remember exactly what Joe said, but when Joe broke
like
it down,
perfect, they've got perfect combo.
It feels like, right, so you've gone for a dive in the ocean, you've swam through all the kelp, you've come out and you're on the coast, right? Yeah. And you have one of these. So would you like one?
Yeah, please. Yeah. That'd
make
be great.
Yourself one as well. When you say people want an alternative to gin, one thing I've noticed is it doesn't say on there non-alcoholic spirit at all.
No,
you haven't gone down that route of calling it a non-alcoholic spirit.
No, I think there's lots of reasons why these aren't spirits. For me, they're all aperitifs. You have them, you have drinks like this as an aperitif generally. They open up your palate, all that side of things. But also, I don't feel totally comfortable calling things spirits if they don't have the alcohol in.
Exactly. Yeah, that's exactly the answer I was hoping you'd come out with. Because I feel it's a little bit, it's a little bit difficult to understand that as a consumer you're like, oh, non-alcoholic gin, but actually it's, you know, it's not really gin.
I totally get why people do it, and I don't have a big issue with it. I just don't want to do it myself. I mean, I can see for a lot of brands that trying to get people to understand what they are, it's a super simple shortcut for people to say,
that's it, yeah,
this is non-alc gin.
But and so have you had
any understand that.
Like struggles trying to explain to people what a non-alcoholic aperitif is,
I'm a bartender. I love chatting to people about products and talking to them, yeah. And in a bar having that conversation with guests is one of the most exciting parts of the job to me, that interaction. But we can't do that in a supermarket, we can't do that online. It is a bit difficult to communicate when you don't have that face-to-face interaction with someone. So this is the driest of them all. So one of the issues non-alc alternatives have is when you taste the neat, they can be challenging to decipher.
I'm getting a lot of a kind of a citrus note to it.
So it's quite a lot of bergamot in there. There's a little bit of sea buckthorn on the nose as well, which is a kind of a pineapple-y
bit. It's balanced.
It's
so funny. I like tasting spirits like that in my mind. If I think like, ooh, I got to drive later on.
this is the lightest of the flavor profiles.
When you make one of these, what would your proportions be? I think they're on the bottle, aren't they?
1 to 3, by
one
and large. So large measure and top it up in a highball with plenty of ice. We use a bit of sea salt in this as well, which actually is a nod to where I'm going to be moving, is Icelandic sea salt.
Yeah, that's so exciting. Are you looking forward to moving to Iceland? Will you have to travel back very often, or?
I expect I will be a bit, but... we've all shown how remote working can work this year, so I'm hoping that...
Yeah, this is the year of moving to remote.
I'm looking forward to space and openness and wilderness. It should be quite exciting. But yeah, this salt is actually evaporated water that uses the geothermal heat in Iceland. So it doesn't require any energy source to evaporate.
Oh, nice, okay.
It's all geothermal energy.
So it's kind of, it's you know, more carbon neutral, I guess.
Yeah, we try and kind of tell a story with all the ingredients that we choose. And
would you put a little...
A citrus.
A citrus on there?
A bit of citrus, slice of citrus.
Yeah, you can do that.
If you've got. We use gum acacia in all of them to give texture and mouthfeel.
The mouthfeel is quite good. And it hasn't got that, I think one of the things I've noticed with non-alcoholic alternatives is that there's a lot of spice put in them to replicate that burn that you get from spirit.
Yeah, I purposely haven't done that.
It didn't have that, yeah. I was going to ask, was that done on purpose?
Again, I totally get why people do that, but to me the pleasure of alcoholic drinks is not the burn.
Yeah.
It's the complexity and the interesting flavour, so it's not a route I've gone down, but...
Yeah, I
see why.
Quite like that, to be fair. All right.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Here's the day drinking.
Mm.
That's lovely tonic.
It's good, isn't it? If you want to taste the tonic by itself, where's a small glass? Right. So that's delicious, and that's nice, easy serve. I would personally have put that with the ruby grapefruit. I think it would have been like blow out the park type delicious.
Yep. We just have a little bit of thyme in there, so a sprig of thyme works nicely as well.
That's really nice. That's actually really, really nice.
It's quite refreshing. I like the umaminess that comes through.
I think I like this one better than that one. I'm going to taste that as
well. You just like new shiny things.
I do like new shiny things. I love the packaging as well. That's so well designed. All right, last but not least, mountain. So what is mountain? Is this like the biggest one? So it's kind of inspired by the mountain from the Game of Thrones?
No.
No?
Definitely not. So with this one, I wanted something that was kind of taking the more floral notes of this one, but retaining a bit of the bitterness. So it's less bitter and more floral. And it's, again, it's a hypothetical mountain that kind of starts off with Japanese cherry blossom at the bottom.
Nice.
So we use a lot of sakura from Japan. And then as you go up the mountain, there's a bit of kind of alpine strawberry flavor. And then as you go up near the top, when it gets colder, you've got rose hips, obviously very seasonal at the moment. You've got some wormwood in there as well, a couple of different wormwoods we use in that one. And a bit of kind of black cherry to augment the cherry blossom.
And I don't know if people can see this, but the label's textured. I love all the little details. It's textured, right?
Yeah,
is it
is.
Just me?
Yeah. No, it's a bit bubbly as well. That's why the bottles are cold. But yeah, there's loads of texture. There are some little metallic highlights in there.
Yeah, I noticed
just
that
to dial up the complexity, really. We're trying to explain to people these are really complex liquids that you should kind of enjoy and take time over rather than being a quick switch out for a spirit. It should be
and
good in their own right.
Is this a stock bottle?
It is, yeah.
Okay. I'll steal that bottle if I yeah. if I launch my
can give me the juice. I would say that it's an absolute pain in the ass to label a tapered bottle like that. if you look on the back right. There's very few tapered bottles with a big label on, for good reason, I've discovered.
All right, so.
So the journey for mountain is, yeah, kind of going up the mountain through these blossom forests and past some alpine strawberries and up to rose hips and picking up some wormwood on the way.
Is there a strawberry in there?
Yeah, there's a little bit of strawberry.
Okay.
Just a hint. It's not kind of a pink gin strawberry punch. It's a little bit of sweetness.
For some reason, I wasn't expecting you to be doing like a candied strawberry pink gin type thing. It just doesn't feel like your kind of personality, does it? Right.
We've not tried to make direct comparisons to spirits. We try and make things that stand up in their own
right. This smells so fruity. There's something in there that's kind of like, it's like a marshmallowy.
Okay.
Oh, what is that?
Marshmallow
that
is probably
smells
the,
like happiness.
The cherry blossom is just such an awesome thing. It was so expensive to get from Japan, especially given the logistics of COVID. But it's such a good ingredient. I absolutely love it. If anything, this is my new favourite.
Wow.
Can't really have a favourite kid, though.
No, you can't play favourites, can you? This is so good. And your recommendation on this is the same sort of thing, that this with tonic and then garnish with strawberries.
For our kind of consumer recommended serves, yeah, we're putting them all with tonic. We use different glasses for them, so big balloons for this one generally. But, I mean, we don't like to tell bartenders what to do with them. This is kind of going... Use your own creativity.
Let them do their own thing,
but,
right?
I love this is a sour with a little bit of maraschino cherry juice. is wonderful.
Okay. Well, I guess we could do that, right?
Yeah. Whatever.
Yeah.
Takes your fancy, really.
Do you mind?
No, please do.
All right. Now, what I'm going to do first, because I didn't get to put Mitch's Minute out yesterday, is I'm going to put out a Mitch's Minute, which will take a minute, and then we'll come back and we'll make some cocktails with these. Awesome. So, Mitch's Minute.
Top Scottish single grain whiskey. Well, some of the highlights of the year for me have been the back-to-back MMA cards. The MMA was the first sport that got back on its feet, and how they sort of led the sports world and getting back going. That's been great. Lots of fights. I got to spend lots of time with my wife and my dog, even though it's all been indoors predominantly. That's been nice. I think correspondence amongst friends have increased. And while it's been sad to watch some venues go down the gurgler, especially, you know, your friends who have worked so hard, some of the innovation I think will be permanent, and that's been great. I also like that people have had so much time on the internet that they're starting to see how vacuous the Instagram bartender is and what a load of shit that all is. So, yeah, let's hope 2021 is the year that we banish them.
Was Mitch's minute. I ran and got more tonic.
Excellent.
Because I really want to taste it with tonic as well as soon as I can. And you tried Sackford's before, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of my favourites.
Interestingly, the prickly pear one, Nightjar's just done a prickly pear cocktail with marine.
So oh, nice.
Seems to be a thing that's catching on.
Prickly pear.
Prickly pear and Everleaf marine.
So have you had many bars create cocktails with them?
We've worked with a few bartenders in lockdown, which we haven't kind of shared yet, but we've been trying to work out ways to work with everybody during lockdown.
And
getting a few bartenders to make drinks has been one of the ways we can do that.
But, yeah.
It's
It's been a tough couple of months, hasn't it?
Yeah. So we've had all the excitement around launching these, and at the same time we've had all the juggling with our venues, trying to work out how we can cope, how we can survive. Fortunately, we've had very understanding landlords and
some support from there. So you've had good dealings with your landlords?
We have, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good thing. It's nice to hear someone had a good dealing with them.
Hasn't removed all the challenges for sure, but they have been good and supportive.
I might do it in one of these little jobbies. I'm starting to get a bit of a taste for a three-piece. Right. So when you say you are sour, what sour recipe would you use? Are you just doing a straightforward sour? Are you adding sugar?
Yeah.
Because I don't find these to be. You'd be forgiven for assuming that there's plenty of sugar in these, but they're not. They're not sweet.
No, not at all.
They're actually quite dry.
I mean, marine's 60 grams a litre sugar. Mountain's 90, and forest is 120. So they're pretty low. I mean, if you look at spritz type aperitifs, they might be three or four times that. So,
all right. Now I'm just going to add sugar because I've not dealt with this before to taste.
Yeah, I'd probably go a tiny bit lighter on the sugar than you would do for a sugar-free spirit. But so you've got bitterness in mountain from a couple of different wormwoods, but then for each variety, I've kind of snuck in an interesting botanical, if you like, something that's a bit out of the ordinary.
The botanist.
So forest, I know, it's a couple of years now since we last talked about it, but forest has got a vetiver in it.
Yeah.
So that's used more traditionally in perfumery.
Yeah.
There's that kind of earthy, musky relative of lemongrass. So that's a really interesting note in there. With mountain, we've got something called everlasting.
Yeah.
So everlasting is a flower that retains its colour forever. So when you dry it, it keeps
really?
The bright yellow colour.
Wow. Is that in their full colour?
No, not at all. It's when you smell the leaf, it's also known as a curry plant. So it's kind of curry smelling leaf, but it's actually more like sage or wormwood when you use it in the drink. So it dials up the kind of wormwoody, sagey note to it. But that's a really fun one to use in there. And then in marine, we've got labdanum, which is something that's been used occasionally for vermouths, but actually the use of it goes back thousands of years. The ancient Egyptians used to use it as a perfume. So that gives a really interesting complexing note, if you like. So they've all got little complexing things to make them a bit more interesting. had a lot of fun over the botanicals. And one of the things I haven't been able to do this year is actually get out to see where we're getting everything from and visit them. I was supposed to go out to Madagascar twice to look at where we're getting our vanilla from, and that's been called off twice. So
yeah, vanilla.
Next time scheduled for February. So fingers crossed.
I never actually released the video that I. Oh wait, I've lost you. Where did you go?
Hopefully, I'm still there on the mic.
Oh my god! Sorry, guys.
It's all right.
Sorry, you could hear. Yeah, I
it's much better looking at it, Dean.
I didn't realise I'd done that. People still had your audio, right? Yeah. Okay. I'm actually quite excited for this. So I've put, like you said, I've done the sour, and then I've just put a cherry at the bottom, and I've had a little bit of the cherry syrup come in, so it's adding that extra little bit of cherry to it. I should make two.
You should. Don't worry, you go for it.
There you go. I'll make another one real quick.
If you've got a tasting glass, I'll splash a bit in there.
No, it's all right. I'll make another one. I can make one more and close out. What do you think?
Oh, lovely.
Is that nice?
Really nice, yeah. It's a little bit of salinity comes through as well, which is good. We use a little bit of Himalayan mountain salt in mountain.
Nice.
Again, a little reference.
And it's real Himalayan mountain salt?
Yeah, it's real Himalayan
mountain salt. There was like a whole controversy of someone like lying about pink, Himalayan pink mountain salt. Did you ever hear about that?
I've heard all sorts of stories.
Yeah, there was a guy, like, he was saying it was Himalayan mountain salt, when in fact it just totally wasn't.
It was salt blocks with a bit of colouring.
So I've done 30 and then 20 mils in this sour. I'm so thirsty for one of these now.
That's great, it's nice and tart.
And then 60. Yeah, I didn't want it to be too sweet. I am nursing a hellish hangover from last night. Oh, it's so good.
It is. It's very tasty. Thank you. It's very nice day drinking like this. You kind of forget that it doesn't have the alcohol in.
It does. It doesn't feel like. I would drink alcohol for the flavour, even if it didn't get me drunk.
Well, totally. Like, I mean, that's look at the products you've got on the back bar. There are far cheaper things that will get you drunk if that's the objective.
Yeah.
Why would you drink great whiskey if your sole objective is to get drunk?
I just like the flavour.
Exactly with these, we're about flavour. I really want these to taste great. That's the objective. It's not about, if you're not drinking, then this will do. It's about choosing things that you actually really enjoy and have great character to them.
I quite like the ritual of making the cocktails.
Yeah, absolutely.
And being able to consistently keep doing it. The one thing is, I guess it would start to get, I would get so carried away, I'd go through a bottle in an afternoon.
Well, you probably do that with some of those as well.
I do, yeah, I do. I have gone through quite a bit.
It's allowed, it's allowed with these.
Exactly. It's safe. What sort of price range do they land? So if I go into Sainsbury's, are you in Sainsbury's? Are you in like
Forest,
supermarkets
Forest
now?
Is in Sainsbury's, and all three are in M&S now.
Oh, nice. Okay. Well, yeah. M&S makes it easy. Does that mean you can get them delivered on Ocado?
Not yet. Hopefully soon. Cheers. But cheers. Thank you very much.
That looks so nice.
We're also doing a lot more through our own website now these days. But wow. I think the thing for me has been that a lot of bartenders are using them with alcohol now, which to me shows that they're good enough to stand in their own right. They're not an alternative to.
I was literally just thinking. Have you tasted this?
I haven't yet. No.
So Glendalough Rose Gin. It's an Irish rose gin. That and that are going to taste amazing.
Fantastic. So
that's my next. I'm going to make a hardcore rose martini next. Would it be a gimlet?
Yeah.
Right. I might still make that.
Cherry blossom and rose.
What am I thinking? I'm thinking I can't just keep banging drinks. One more.
Cherry blossom and rose gimlet.
One more. Cherry blossom and rose gimlet. Let's see if it works. And then we'll sign out for the day. You can go back to your life. And I will clean all the mess that I've been making over the last couple of nights.
Go back to the bar, because we have one bar open now.
Oh, nice. Is this the one in Bermondsey?
So it's the Hyde on Bermondsey Street we've reopened.
Nice.
The ones in the city, it's just so dead still.
But, and you've always done substantial food, so that's a bonus.
We'll have the Hyde, yeah.
Yeah, and it's not just Scotch eggs.
No. Oh, it's been a nightmare,
hasn't
it?
If one thing comes out of this, it'll be there'll be a couple of great Scotch egg recipes coming out of
lockdown. Whole thing's ridiculous. Anyway,
let's
not go into that.
So I'm going to put 60 of the rose gin.
Just hope we can stay open a bit longer before we get locked down again.
I'm going to put a blind 30.
Hopefully that's it.
Do you think we're going to get locked down again?
I don't know. The one thing I've learned this year is not to predict anything with any certainty.
Yeah, it's a total chaos, isn't it?
Really right. Testing our ability to adapt as an industry.
Well, I'm hoping that people form some sort of lobby or alliance of some sort. I would have thought that would have happened much earlier, but I haven't seen it.
We've been great at supporting each other as an industry, and the amount of creativity and invention that's come out of it has been incredible, to see the number of brands and the packaged cocktails and the branding that's gone into those and the ways people are adapting. And
oh, it's very pink.
It is very pink.
So I've done 60 of the gin, 30 of Mountain. No.
Yeah, Mountain.
Yeah, Mountain. Right. I might do a lemon twist on it, actually. What do you think? Would a lemon twist work?
Yeah.
Ah. Grapefruit twist. I'm upgrading my twists.
Pink grapefruit, no less, is it?
Yeah, it's the ruby grapefruit. That's what I thought would work really well with the... what was this one again? I don't want to get it wrong. Marine. Yeah. All right. Do you want to taste this?
You taste it.
Yeah? Can I have it?
Yeah, it's all right. You have it.
Oh, it's amazing. Wow.
So, yeah, okay. I mean, using these light vermouths is a lovely way of doing it as well.
It's coming back. So rose and mountain.
So rose hip and cherry blossom would be the two key ones on that.
And you can taste the strawberry still coming through as well. There's like that little soft hint of strawberry. I think this, to be fair,
I'm enjoying that
a lot. I think this is really enjoyable. Awesome. So, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks very much for having me again.
If I'm going to try to cut out a 30-second piece that I can put on Instagram to promote this show, right? So, in 30 seconds, how would you explain the range?
All non-alcoholic aperitifs. We started with the original, which is forest. So a journey through a forest, lots of bittersweet, earthy, barky flavours with a few bits of blossom in there. With marine, it's that swim through a kelp forest and then lie back on the beach while you get bergamot and an olive leaf smells coming down over you. And then mountain is this journey up through cherry blossom, up past alpine strawberries, up to the top where there are rose hips and a bit of traditional kind of bittersweet vermouth ingredients in there as well. Amazing. So they're all journeys through biomes, journeys through ecosystems.
Journeys of
botanical journeys.
Amazing. Cheers, man. Thank you. Thank you for coming on again.
Thank you very much indeed.
Awesome. And that's been our day drinking afternoon session. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll see you next time.